We are back with our next interview. We have Wilson. Wilson, thanks for joining us.
Well, that's great. I had a good time talking with you. Our dinner last night.
And I know.
Lunches. And
I get to spend a lot of time with Wilson. We've been talking about just the vibe here, kind of how it feels and the differences, and it feels a little different this year.
Yeah, I think AI and this whole idea of this, you know, whether it's going to kill us or not.
Right, yes.
It's really a great situation here.
Well, it's funny. We've been talking about it for a long time, right? So Jason and I have done these interviews, like you and I, for years, and it was almost like no one understood or woke up for a couple of years. Like Jason would be talking about it, and it felt like for a long time, you know, there were very few people having the conversation, mm-hmm. and now it's expanding, and more people are having the conversations, I think, and trying to figure all of that out. So I think you see a lot more of that, right?
Yeah, you know, during drinks the other night with Jason, you and I, I really kind of came up with a revelation that, you know, Jason was telling us about how he's just not a nonconformist.
Right.
You know,
right.
And I think that really in the age of AI and all these jobs being taken away, really the only sure thing is you got to be a, you know, entrepreneur.
Yeah.
An artist, right?
Yeah.
And a nonconformist.
Yeah.
And a risk taker, so to speak. You know, so we can go into, you know, like ransomware.
Now Wilson encouraging you all to go into ransomware.
So yeah, because historically, every single technology that's come about, there has been some anti-technology around it. You know, back in the Industrial Revolution, and they were these Luddites, right? They called Luddites that came and they broke cotton gin and all those technologies because it took jobs away.
Yes.
Right? And so I'm wondering, like, what's going to happen with these, you know, modern Luddites?
Yes.
You know, it's going to go beyond, you know, Timothy Manning and WikiLeaks. And I think that that's really kind of this ransomware is really going to be. And I'm wondering, who are these people that are getting all this money? Who are they? I mean, we don't know, right?
We don't know.
Do you know who they are?
Yeah. No, I don't.
I know.
Like, me either. No. But it is. It's.
And how do I get that job?
I know, right? Well, one of the questions I was thinking about too, like as we use more automation and things are done for us, right? We rely so much on our technology and our devices and our things. Do we worry at all about what happens when people forget how to do things? Like, literally. You know, they get to the point where, I don't know, like, let's say, for example, we saw this recently with one of the airlines that was hacked and went down.
Yeah.
But they relied so heavily on their automation and lots of pieces in place for them that when that happened, their only choice was to revert back to an old system, right?
Yeah, with the four-digit codes.
Exactly, that's what they had to do because they couldn't assure that the new one they'd put in was viable and, you know, was clean, right, for a while. So in order to get business back up and running, they had to literally revert back to something they hadn't used in years.
Yeah, and hire back all of the retirees.
Right, right know how to do that.
Yeah, 32 green screens. And
Like, what do you do, right? Like, when we forget, and we'll raise generations of people, right, that just talk to things and things do things for them, right? But, like, what if you lose your phone and your GPS goes out and you need to get somewhere?
Yeah, well, that's why I'm fascinated with these hand motion stuff. Like, you know, there's a drill that you can just spin and it actually works, right?
Yeah. Right.
And
right. So, what if it fails, right? Like, what if all the automated or mechanical and all the pieces fail, then what do you do?
Yeah, so this should be a university for that.
Yeah. To teach people, like, how to remember how to do things. Because did you see, I was talking to folks about it the other day, there was a video on the rotary phones, you know, the old rotary phones. Have you seen this video?
Yeah, I've actually used one.
There's a video on it where they put it in a room with.
What do you do?
And they didn't know what to do. They put in a room with several college students, current college students.
Yeah.
And they're like, "How do you use this?" And they all looked at each other and like, were like, "I'm not sure. Why don't you tell me?" They didn't know. So it's a whole video they didn't know what to do with that, right? So it's interesting to see things that, and I was just talking to the gal before, she talks about how you retain and hire millennials. And one of the things she was saying is the generation coming behind that group now is the first native tech generation. Like, they've completely grown up with all the things, right? All the technology. So it'll be interesting to see as things change with new people entering, new ideas.
Yeah, like I emailed my daughter.
Yeah.
And she goes, well, how come you didn't reply? She goes, like, oh, yeah, emails for old people.
Emails for old people.
Yeah. Yeah. But, you know, it's really funny. I think she was absolutely right because
right.
I was just reading this one guy. He had an article that says, okay, this transformation. It says, first, get rid of email.
Yes.
Because you want to talk to people, and that's how you influence.
Yes.
And, you know, you just piss people off with email. And I find that out, you know, more than anything, you know. It's really true. So I think it's really looking at the technology that's being used. Like, for example, in the classes that I create, what I've been doing is creating videos of this, and I play the video while, you know, instead of talking, so that way I can see what people are doing, you know, what they're, do they get it, and so forth, just give me feedback.
Oh, that's amazing.
Yeah, and I think that, you know, we really need to try different modes of communication.
Right, you know, exactly, and see what's working and what works better and changing that up.
Yeah.
Yeah, I had heard that too, that there were some companies that were actually saying they were doing the same thing, like eliminating email. So only unless you had to use email, but use other mechanisms to communicate instead of email and trying to avoid that flood of hundreds of emails everyone gets every single day and those types of things.
The trouble is that people read into emails what it is, like, you know, anger or, or you know, or snarkiness, you know, and so forth.
Right.
Yeah.
All those
exactly.
things.
Yeah. And so that's really the, you know, a key is to enhance communication, which is a relationship.
Yeah.
Rather than just, you know, emitting missives of wisdom or whatever.
Yeah.
Or commands.
Exactly. Yeah. No, I agree. Yeah. That's, And now from the sessions you've taken, have you done any today yet? Sessions?
Yeah, it was yesterday.
Okay.
Yeah, yesterday. And the same thing we were talking about, Jenna, with her security thing about whether to, you know, how do you get people to recognize security? You know, they're in this FedRAMP program with these, what you have to, the controls that you need to put in. There's something like 800 of those.
Wow.
Yeah, these controls that you have to put in. And so the technique is we want to figure out, like, how do we get that to people to accept that? Because that's one of the biggest concerns with Agile.
Absolutely.
And it's for developers to accept that to work in production. Because a lot of times what they do is they just take shortcuts. And those shortcuts end up in production and expose all kinds of security issues. Mm-hmm. So how do you get them to work in production mode? And part of this, one of the things I've done is put together a, you know, in DevOps, have it automatically scan whatever they, you know, they put into GitHub. And so that way they can see, or Docker, so they can see that, okay, here are the vulnerabilities that you have, but it's the explanation of those and why each of those are needed that are really, you know, a key. You know, that has to be done on a personal basis. Like, for example, one the other day, I just filed a request to CIS, who maintains this list of vulnerabilities, and I said, okay, you know, this particular one, I think this is outdated, you know?
Yeah.
And I had the gall to do that.
To tell them.
And I got an email back.
Well, that says, okay, we're accepting. Did they respond to an email?
They said, thank you very much. We put that under consideration.
We'll put it,
But at least they didn't say, like, you know,
that.
How dare you, you know?
Right? But they used email for old people to tell you. Yeah,
right,
that's
to tell me that. We'll get back to you. Yeah.
We'll get back to you at some point. We'll take it under advisement. Anything else you're seeing as kind of trends, things that are top of mind right now for you?
Well, I think it's the question really is, you know, what people are going to do when the robots and the automated trucks and over. And I really think that it's really a responsibility of the companies, you know, and responsibility of politicians, really, and their, to figure out what their people, what they're going to do, and set up programs now. I mean, we're talking about what within 5 years it's going to be over, right? I think so, right?
Yeah.
If you listen to Elon, I do. He says, "Oh yeah, the end of this year." He's saying we're already feature complete to do autonomous driving, and that means that all the taxi drivers, all of the truck drivers, you know.
Oh yeah, they said that industry will be hit the hardest right away, right? And that's a lot of people.
Yeah, so I mean, what are these people, what are you gonna do with these people?
Yeah, retooling and retraining and repurposing, and what do people do? That's gonna be a huge thing.
Yeah.
And that's why I think you're seeing, like, we just thought they were talking about, you know, like you had said, government's talking about programs of what do we do for minimum income and things like that, and how do you implement something that would help assist with that? Because it is gonna be a growing number of people that are impacted and see changes.
Yeah, and I think it's really a you know, ethical issue and a political one, and I think it's really going to be, to me, it seems like the, you know, communism or whatever of today's world.
Yeah.
You know, in the 50s,
yeah.
you can't believe in that.
Right.
And so the question is, you know, what is the fundamental belief of what a particular person is worth?
Yeah.
Is it that, you know, if somebody who doesn't work doesn't eat, you know,
is that
really what we're about?
Right. Yeah. And well, and it's interesting too. I mean, we look at certain countries, they already have something, right, where they've said in order to make sure we take care of people, like there's minimum standards of living, right? So everyone gets a job and we make sure everyone first has a job and a place to live. Right? So if people can eat and they have a place to live, then they've found we have less issues with other things, right? Because we're taking care of minimum items that people need, right? And those types of things. So, but it is going to be globally an issue, you know, for a lot of us.
Yeah, this is, as a presidential candidate who's running on the platform of universal basic income.
Yeah.
And I think that is really a debate that needs to happen.
Well, and I think it's awareness too, though, right? I mean, like we talked about, this stuff's been around for a long time. People are now just kind of waking up and going, oh shoot, it's real. Like this is gonna happen, right? It's not fake and it's not happening. And then you have to first be aware that something's happening to know that now we need to do something.
It'll be too late by then.
Right, that there's really gonna be an impact though, and getting people to see that. Cause I think there's a lot of people that didn't realize, you know, that it was gonna have the impact it was. And now we're dealing with, okay, now what, you know? How do we handle it?
Jeremiah and I, before this, we came up with a solution for ourselves. Yeah,
good. I'm sure you guys really had great. Wilson, he's built all the things. You're getting it here first. So if you're tuned in, invest in this now.
It would be a robot cleaning service. Yeah. So that's the one job we can think of that will still be around when robots take over.
A robot cleaning
service. Yeah.
Okay. All right, that's amazing.
So you heard it here first.
You heard it here first. So when they see that come out, they can invest.
All right, that's my new company.
The robot cleaning service. That's amazing.
You know you'll still be needed.
Yeah.
You'll have health care.
That's amazing. I love it. That's awesome. Well, Wilson, what else do you have this week? Do you have or are you done with all of
that? No, I'm partying. You know,
you just get to hang out and have
yeah,
fun.
Yeah, isn't that great?
Right? Oh. Jealous. I'm super jealous. That sounds amazing. Any good sessions you are going to attend this week that you've decided yet? Did you look?
Yeah, I'm looking for Jeremiah's. I'm looking forward to your keynote with Jeremiah's. I think it'd be great.
Yeah.
So looking forward to it.
I know. We're blending all the tech with the people part. So that was our idea.
Yeah.
Yep.
Looking forward to it. All right. Thanks again.
Yeah, this was great. Wilson, I appreciated having you. If people want to talk to you more, which they probably do, they want to invest in that robot cleaning service. How do they find you?
Oh, it's not hard. It's like I'm WilsonMarr dot, one word, M-A-R dot github.io. And I've got all the stuff, more than you ever want to know about anything.
Than anything.
A
good resource, though, to go find all the things.
Yeah, so I write about stuff. And I've got this new thing I'm working on to do performance testing in the cloud. Huh? What do you do to save money?
Yeah.
Because there's all kinds of intricacies, you know, with getting scaling up.
Yeah.
And so forth, right?
Ooh,
and
they may want to hear more about that.
Yeah, so take a look at it. And it's cloud.perftest is on. But, you know, the thing is, with Amazon, they have this thing called Fargate.
Yeah.
Where you can put a Docker image in there, and it will take care of the scaling up and out. And so as a result, I think really the key to the ultimate thing of what's happening with Amazon and all that is really just you become a kind of an entrepreneur.
Yes.
That you don't need to have an IT department. You just say, okay, this is what I want.
Right.
And just put this together. So,
and
I think that's really another, you know, really seriously, the survival tactic for automation age is to make use of that and come up with a good idea.
Yep.
In order for, and then all the automation will be, you know, taken care of for you.
Yeah. No, great idea.
So make, you know, Jeff Bezos another $1 trillion.
Yeah, yeah, he needs more money.
Yeah.
I heard. All right, thanks, Wilson.
Thank you.
We will be back shortly with more interviews. Stay tuned for more of our virtual interviews.